Well, it's great to be back in the National Liberty Museum, and we thank Peggy and Gwen for hosting us. You may notice I have a little hat on my head. These are going like hotcakes. We've sold 80 hats in the last week after announcing it on social media. So we're selling them in the back for $20 a cap. Make America Think Again with our logo on the back. And it goes right along with our longtime slogan, a nation must think before it acts. So we hope to keep thinking and help you keep thinking. It is a really personal pleasure for me to bring to you tonight John Maurer, who it's hard for me to believe I met 40 years ago when he was an intern at the Foreign Policy Research Institute. He got his BA at Yale and went on to get a doctorate at Fletcher School at Tufts, during which time I think he came back as a pre-doctoral fellow at FPRI, and then he became a senior research fellow at FPRI, and then he landed at the U.S. Naval War College, where he's been for at least the last 25 years. He was chairman of the Policy and Strategy Department there. He is now the Alfred Thayer Mahan Professor of Sea Power and Grand Strategy. He has served on the Secretary of Navy's Advisory Committee on Naval History. He has received the Navy's Meritorious Civilian Service Award and Superior Civilian Service Award. He has lectured for us six times in the past few years at the New York Historical Society, basically because they keep inviting him back. And he is really, and they're all on Churchill, the lectures, six different lectures on Churchill. He really is a phenomenal intellect. Back in the 1970s, I remember him coming to the office, and whatever day it was, he could tell you what happened 500 years ago or 1,000 years ago on that day. It was truly incredible. Anyway, he is here tonight to speak on Churchill, Roosevelt, Stalin, and the origins of the Grand Alliance, or to put it more snappily, 1941. So please welcome Dr. John Maurer.
Thank you, Alan, for inviting me, and thank you to his staff. Alan's staff is not only efficient, but also very nice. They're great to work with, wonderful people. And that's been a tradition at the Foreign Policy Research Institute as well, just wonderful people to work with. And I am proud of the time that I served at the Foreign Policy Research Institute. I am a native Philadelphian, as you might be able to garner from my speech, though I have lived a big chunk of my life, more than half my life now, in New England, between New Haven and Newport, Rhode Island. So if I'm losing some of my Philadelphia accent, please forgive me. I grew up in Northeast Philadelphia and went to the Lincoln High School up in the Northeast Philadelphia. And my family, I have two sisters and a brother that still live in the Philadelphia area, so I'm always glad to be able to come back to Philadelphia. Thank you. I cannot get over all the buildings that are taking place. I walked across town today over to the FPRI offices, and all the building that's going on, it's just incredible. I can't get over it. I mean, Philadelphia looks like a boom town, the way all the building and the cranes and the rest. It's remarkable, just remarkable. Well, I'm going to talk about the events of 1941, 75 years ago. So that's what my theme is going to be, to look at the events of that year. That year is one of the major turning points in world history. And one of the big themes I want you to take away from this talk, the reason why 1941 is so important, is because the United States in some way matured and grew up to be a world power. Already the United States was an economic superpower before 1941. It had by far the world's largest economy. But at the same time, it didn't exert leadership on the world stage. 1941 and the events of 1941 forced the United States to take on a role of world leadership. And that's one of the great continuities from that time to our own time. Think about that. 75 years of history, that one of the major themes, one of the great continuities of history is the role of the United States playing a leadership role. And one of the things that we confront today as a people is how much does our country want to continue to play that role on the world stage. So what I'm talking about today is the beginning of an era in which the United States had to play a larger role. And its role was critical, critical in determining the outcome of the Second World War. Now, two great leaders of that time, Winston Churchill and Franklin D. Roosevelt. And here they are meeting in August of 1941. Behind them are two admirals on the right, Admiral Harold Betty, his nickname, Betty Stark, who was then the chief of naval operations, the top uniformed leader of the Navy at that time. And next to him, Admiral Ernest J. King, who would become the chief of naval operations during the Second World War. Both of them were graduates of the Naval War College in Newport, Rhode Island. So this is something I want to highlight, is the role of the institution where I now teach, where I'm an educator, has played a role also in America's history over the last 130-some years. Now, the relationship of that time to today, our own election year of 2016. We want to feel the burn, feel the burn. Way back earlier in this year, in a debate between Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders, they were both asked to name two world leaders, one American, one foreigner, who played a leadership role that they admired. Well, Bernie Sanders came back and said Franklin D. Roosevelt and Winston Churchill. And here's why. As he said, Churchill was a great wartime leader who rallied the British people against that Nazi juggernaut and led them to eventual victory. By the way, Bernie Sanders took a lot of heat from the left of the political spectrum in saying, how can you say that Winston Churchill, he was an imperialist. Yeah, you know, he was a very conservative individual. I have no doubt that Winston Churchill right now, the shade of Winston Churchill, is probably smiling and chuckling that an American socialist decided to nominate him as one of the great leaders of the 20th century. Well, what I want to do is give you the story of 1941. And it'll be like a great Shakespearean play of five acts. And so I'm going to give you five acts in telling this story about 1941. Act one, averting defeat. At the beginning of 1941, the world was in a very dangerous place. Here you see a German two-engine bomber flying over London. That's the Thames River, Greenwich, right below, in broad daylight. Imagine this. Enemy aircraft, bombers, flying over your capital in broad daylight. Well, that's the situation that Britain faced in 1940. The bomber was getting through, causing immense amount of damage to the British homeland. This iconic photograph of the bombing of the city of London, St. Paul's Cathedral, damage to St. Paul's Cathedral. It was thought maybe Christopher Wren's great dome might even collapse under the heavy bombing. Fires inside the cathedral as well. Well, this photograph, of course, broadcast around the world, became very famous and showed, again, British defiance to the Germans, despite the heavy bombing that the British took. It should be remembered how many British lives were lost in the homeland to German bombing. Between August of 1940 and December of 1940, that period of time, often referred to as the Blitz, over 25,000 British civilians were killed by German bombing. Think about that. Think about that. Think about it in relation to the events of September 11th. That's the equivalent of 7 or 8 in loss of life, 7 or 8 September 11th attacks on the British homeland, on British cities. And yet, the British people were able not only to survive, but keep on kicking, keep on fighting back against the Germans. Here's another photograph from the spring of 1941. This shows the House of Commons, which was bombed and destroyed by German bombers in the spring of 1941. And of course, those of us remembering the events of September 11th, thinking back on those days, when I look at this photograph, I think, where was that fourth airliner going? That airliner where the brave people aboard that airliner took matters into their own hands and fought back. Of course, they did not survive. That plane crashed in Pennsylvania. But where was it heading? Was it heading to the White House? Was it heading to the Capitol? We can only imagine what great damage that airliner could have done if it had gotten through to its target. Well, Britain's historic buildings are taking a pounding as well as loss of life. Well, Churchill appears on Time magazine, Man of the Year, because of his defiant role at the end of 1940. This is the third time that Churchill appeared on the cover of Time magazine. And what you see in the background are destroyers, American destroyers, that had been given to Britain in return for American access to British bases in the Western Hemisphere, a deal that was being worked out between the United States and Britain, destroyers for bases. At this critical time, the United States is starting to provide support to Britain in its fight against Nazi Germany. And this cover of Time magazine is capturing that. American support destroyers being turned over, used by Britain's Royal Navy to help defend Britain against the Germans. Now, in 1940, France was defeated in June of 1940 in a major upset that had been predicted by no one. The French armed forces capitulated after only 6 weeks of fighting. Churchill went to the British chiefs, his top military leaders, and said, if France is defeated, what are the odds? What are our chances of continuing the war successfully against Germany with the defeat of France? Well, the chiefs came back, and if you go to the National Archives out in Kew Gardens in London, this is what you'll find. This is the first page of the chief's assessment. And they highlight, bottom line, right up front, for the chiefs, Britain would be able to continue the war, the British military chiefs said, if the United States is willing to give us full economic and financial support. But then they highlighted in italics, if the United States doesn't provide that support, Britain has no chance of being able to continue the war successfully against Nazi Germany. Already, what you see is a major player, country in the world. The choices it's making are dependent upon what the United States will do. Churchill is placing a bet on the United States that the United States will support Britain in this fight against Nazi Germany. Did he know that that would happen with any certainty? Of course not. He was making the history. He was making the history. He doesn't know the outcome yet. Will the United States withdraw into itself, or will it provide that support for Britain? Churchill's goal in his foreign policy and his strategy is to help get the United States involved in this fight against Nazi Germany. And again, his chiefs are saying, the war can be won, but it requires the United States' assistance. Otherwise, Britain cannot continue the war successfully. Well, this wasn't new to Churchill. Churchill was involved in the First World War in high leadership positions. He held the Ministry of Munitions in Britain. He was involved in the buildup of Britain's armed forces, weaponry, in 1917 and 1918. And here you see him in 1917 giving a speech. You can see him there pounding his fist, and behind him is his wife, Clementine Churchill. I love that hat that she's wearing there. Very fashionable. The question was asked, how can Britain win the war? This is 1917, the First World War. They said they both begin with A. One is airplanes, and the other is America. So if you want to see a continuity in history, Churchill already in the era of the First World War is saying that Britain's ability to beat Imperial Germany depends upon American assistance. Next year, 1917, of course, is the big anniversary year of the United States entering the First World War, April 1917. So at this point, the United States is already in the war, but Churchill is making clear in his public addresses that American assistance is what's critical, it's decisive in enabling Britain and France to defeat Germany in the Great War, the First World War. Well, Churchill looked to Roosevelt. Now, during the 1930s, Churchill was probably the highest paid journalist in the world. His articles commanded large sums, large fees. And so he wrote an article in the 1930s about Franklin D. Roosevelt. Again, this is before Churchill was prime minister, before the Second World War. And in this article, this is one of the things he had to say about Roosevelt, that already Churchill is saying that Roosevelt will rank high among those Americans who have held the office of president. Again, even before the war, Churchill is seeing in Roosevelt a great leader. Now, why is that? Well, here are some of the attributes, again, from the 1930s that Churchill is witnessing, seeing in Roosevelt's activities. Composure. Roosevelt has composure, but he's active. He's a man of action. While he has composure, he's not somebody who's passive. He has composure, but he also takes action. And so Churchill has already formed a very good opinion of Franklin D. Roosevelt as a potential partner, ally, in the struggle against Nazi Germany. Well, what was the position that the United States faced in the beginning of 1941? This is a global perspective of the Second World War from Fortune magazine during the 1940s. These maps from Fortune magazine, by the way, are wonderful. I wish we had maps of this type of quality to be able to educate the American people. The idea behind these maps, again, was to educate the American people about the dangers that they faced in this period of time. Well, what were the dangers that the United States faced? Well, Nazi Germany occupying Europe after the defeat of France. It's the most powerful country in Europe, working in the Atlantic with submarines, the Battle of the Atlantic, closing that lifeline between North America, between the Great Dominion, Canada, and the United States, and the British homeland. Britain's ability to fight on depends upon being able to keep that North Atlantic sea lane open. If that is closed down by U-boats, Britain loses the war. This is a battle in the North Atlantic that the Allies cannot afford to lose. It is a critical battle. Also, the fear is that Nazi Germany will use the French colonial empire in North America as a springboard to attack the United States and our partners in the Western Hemisphere. So this is one of the fears that the Roosevelt administration has, that Germany will be able to close off the Atlantic sea lane and also start moving against the Western Hemisphere. Also, in East Asia, Japan is at war with China. Beginning in 1937, Japan and China are fighting a major war against each other in which millions of Chinese are being killed and tens of thousands of Japanese soldiers. From 1937 on, in other words, 4 years before Pearl Harbor, China and Japan are waging a major land war in Asia against each other. And the nationalist regime of Chiang Kai-shek is leading the fight against Japan. Well, the fear is that Japan might continue to advance in Asia, not only continue its war against China, and of course we're trying to pressure Japan to give up this war against China, a war that Japan isn't able to bring to a successful conclusion because Chiang Kai-shek is so determined to keep fighting. But the fear is that Japan will move against the British Empire into Southeast Asia, towards Singapore, toward Australia, into the Indian Ocean, and also that Japan might strike north against the Soviet Union in Siberia. So the Roosevelt administration, looking at the world, sees these twin dangers in Europe and in Asia from Germany and from Japan. Roosevelt and the leaders around him are trying to shape the international strategic environment in a way that prevents these two powers, Germany and Japan, from getting stronger, to try to contain them, to weaken them, to then roll back the conquests that they've made. Well, here's Admiral Betty Stark, the chief of naval operations that I mentioned earlier. He's one of the strategists, one of the military leaders, head of the Navy, that Roosevelt turns to. Well, at the end of 1940, Admiral Stark puts together a famous memorandum for the Secretary of the Navy, Frank Knotts, a Republican that Roosevelt has brought into his administration. And He lays out the strategic options open to the United States at the end of 1940, beginning of 1941. These are the courses of action, the COAs, that are confronting the United States. Again, Churchill went to his military chiefs and said, what are our options? Roosevelt is doing the same thing. I want to know what our options are. And so the top uniformed leader of the Navy is coming back. Here are the four options for the United States in the world that they faced at the beginning of 41. One is defend the Western Hemisphere. On this, there's overwhelming political consensus. Even the American firsters, who are hostile to Roosevelt, agree that the Western Hemisphere has to be defended and that any arms buildup by the United States, as long as it's geared toward defending the Western Hemisphere, is legitimate. Option B, offensive in the Pacific against Japan, which again has been at war with China, and stay on the defensive in the Atlantic. C, both Atlantic and Pacific, use American resources in both theaters. Or D, offensive in the Atlantic against Germany, stay on the defensive in the Pacific. This is the option that Roosevelt chooses. It's often referred to as Plan Dog. This is the overall strategic guidance. By the way, of the four options, this is the one that is the most controversial. Again, not only American firsters agree with A, but also within the Roosevelt administration, the Chief of Staff of the Army, George Marshall, he thinks that's the best option. Our ambassador in Great Britain, Joseph Kennedy, the father of President John F. Kennedy, he thinks that that's the right option too. That Britain is in such dire needs that they're likely to lose the war, and any support that goes to Britain will be lost. So better just to hunker down in the Western Hemisphere. So this is a controversial decision behind the scenes that Roosevelt is making to support Britain in the fight against Germany. For Roosevelt, as he said, we have to be the great arsenal of democracy, and that the United States faces an emergency as serious as war itself. Now, notice here the language that he's using to the American people. He's not saying we must be the foot soldiers of democracy. That would have been very unpopular. Americans don't want to send another expeditionary force over to Europe. The First World War was seen as the great aberration. Over 100,000 Americans were killed in the First World War, and it was thought for what purpose? For what purpose? No good had come out of that sacrifice. And so the idea of sending an American army over there, I won't sing anymore, I promise. Oh, maybe I will. Anyway, no more of that over there. The United States will arm other people to fight, but not send our people to fight. Roosevelt liked to say that American mothers were fine dressing up their boys in sailor suits, but they never dressed up their boys in army uniforms. Okay, so that gives an idea of what he has a sound appraisal of American public opinion and how skittish it is and how controversial and unpopular the idea of Plan Dog would be. But again, Roosevelt understands what's at stake here. This isn't just a struggle over power, balance of power. This is an existential struggle for human rights against a vicious, virulent Nazi regime. The heart of Western civilization is a struggle going on. Is the racist agenda of National Socialism going to win out, or is liberal Western democracy going to win out? One or the other has got to triumph. This is a fight to the finish, and Roosevelt understands that. And so, to that high concept, the United States has to be committed, and the end will be victory, total victory, over the Nazi regime. Well, Churchill, this American support, gives a speech. You can go to YouTube, plug it in. It's a wonderful speech, by the way, and it's delivered with that wonderful cadences that Churchill has. You know, what should his response be to Franklin D. Roosevelt? Again, the man who has been chosen three times to lead the American people. At that time, the U.S. had a population of 130 million people. Well, here's the answer to President Roosevelt. And again, this speech has been used by President George W. Bush after September 11th, his speechwriters cribbed off of this speech by Churchill to give President Bush the language, the rhetoric he needed after September 11th to inspire the American people. And in particular, this part of the speech, of Churchill's speech. Shall not fail or falter, weaken or tire, sudden shock of battle, and again after September 11th, that shock to the American people. And again, we know that the terror war is not going to ever be a short war, but has to be a protracted war, given the nature of that conflict, that it be a long, drawn-out struggle. And you can see where President Bush's speechwriters drew upon Churchill's speech. By the way, Churchill wrote all of his own speeches. He did not have speechwriters. He agonized over them. He worked very, very hard on his speeches. And notice here's the end of it. Give us the tools and we will finish the job. I wish I could do that. Again, notice he doesn't say, give us the soldiers and you will finish the job. Again, he understands American public opinion as well. In a democracy, you have to connect with the people. You have to understand what the people want. You have to shape that opinion. But you also understand there's a reality there in that the people have to be consulted, listened to, respected. Well, Churchill here understands American opinion, and he's saying, yes, you give us the weapons. Help us, support us as much as you can, and we will continue this fight against the Germans. Let us go forward together, one of the great posters of the Second World War. Now, what's the German view about all of this, of the American assistance to Britain at this time? Well, this is what the German embassy in Washington is sending back to Berlin. And as you can see, the German Foreign Service is thoroughly corrupted by Nazi ideology. What does the Lend-Lease Act, again, the US being the arsenal democracy, providing weapons, support to Great Britain, well, where does it come from? Well, it's because there's a circle of Jews around the president, and that this is the Jewish worldview is asserting itself in US foreign policy. This helps to explain why the US is doing what it's doing. Again, this is the ideological framework in German, in which German leaders are operating, their worldview, that there's this vast international Jewish conspiracy that controls Britain, the Soviet Union, and the United States. What a weird ideology. And yet, that ideology has a reality to it because the Nazis believe it. Our enemies believe it. Even though it doesn't exist, they believe it. And they act upon it as if it is a reality. Again, that's the frightening reality of 1941. Well, what are Hitler's options? Well, option one is continue to fight Britain. If you have a Germany first strategy that the Admiral Stark is proposing for the United States, why doesn't Germany follow a British first strategy? Keep bombing the British homeland, use submarines to close down that North Atlantic sea lane, strike into the Balkans and toward the Middle East, the British Empire in the Middle East. That's one option. It's argued for among the German leaders by the head of the German Navy, Admiral Erich Raeder. He says this is the strategy Germany should follow. There's another option, though. Option two, attack the Soviet Union. In Hitler's mind, this makes a great deal of sense. Britain is too hard to defeat. The United States aid already by 1941 is making itself felt. The idea of a cross-channel attack, a D-Day in reverse of Germany going across the channel invading Britain, he sees that as being too difficult. In looking at his options, he's come to the conclusion that defeating the Soviet Union is easier than defeating Great Britain. This is the easier of the two options. And so because already American assistance, we're not in the war, but American assistance and British resolve to fight, Churchill's leadership, and also the willingness of the British people to keep fighting, have closed off one option for Hitler so that he sees this as the option that he wants to pursue. In retrospect, we look back and we say, why did he do such a thing? Why did he decide to open up a whole new front against Stalin's Russia? Because we know the history and we know how it's going to turn out. But to Hitler and his military leaders, he thought that this was going to be an easier fight than the fight they've already had against France. France was going to be the tough opponent, not the Soviet Union. And so they're thinking, this is the opportunity to take the Soviet Union down before the United States aid assistance to Britain can make itself fully felt. Well, Churchill knows about the impending invasion of the Soviet Union through signals intelligence, or the British ability to break German codes. And so he constantly is warning Stalin through Stalin's ambassador, Ivan Maisky. There's a photograph of the Soviet ambassador in London. And Maisky keeps a diary. It's just been translated into English and published by the Yale University Press. It's a great read. It's very insightful. Maisky is a committed Red. He's a committed communist. But at the same time, he's a realist. He's a great observer of what's going on in Britain. And he records conversations that he has with British leaders. And in May 1941, six, 7 weeks before the actual German invasion of the Soviet Union, he has a meeting with Churchill, and Churchill says, hey, there's going to be a clash. Hitler's about ready to attack you. And notice Maisky says, this is Churchill's recent tic. Maisky says, Stalin, and we, none of them believe that Hitler would be so stupid as to open a second front at this time by attacking us. So they're downplaying these warnings from Churchill. Churchill knows what's going to happen. But Stalin doesn't want to hear this. This is Churchill's tic. Well, Maisky's a good ambassador. He says, okay, I'll play along with you, Churchill. What if you're right and Nazi Germany does attack the Soviet Union? What will you do? Well, as you can see, Maisky records in his diaries, Churchill's eyes became red, fury in his voice. To crush the Nazis, he's prepared to enter into an alliance with anyone, even the devil. Stalin. You know, the Wicked Witch of the East and West, you know, I'm going to play them off against each other. Okay. I'll make a deal with the devil. But again, he's making clear before the German invasion of the Soviet Union that Britain is there going to be a partner with the Soviet Union, putting aside the ideological differences. Churchill was not an admirer of communism, quite the reverse. But at the same time, because of the war and the danger posed by Nazi Germany, he was willing to make an alliance work with, in partnership with Stalin, to defeat Hitler. Well, the invasion happens. Operation Barbarossa, that is the code word for the German invasion of the Soviet Union, begins on June 22, 1941. We remember December 7, 1941. Well, for peoples of the Soviet Union, for Russian peoples in particular, it's June 22, 1941. Out of the blue, the German armies begin their assault on the Eastern Front against the Soviet Union. And initially, they score major successes. In fact, initially, as you can see, in a very short period of time, they overrun large portions of the Soviet Union, defeat large numbers of Soviet troops, capture millions of Soviet prisoners, and it looks like the war is as good as won by the middle of July 1941, and the German armies can now exploit, moving to Moscow, taking the Ukraine, moving into the Donbass industrial region, the area that now is fought over between Russia and Ukraine, and then down into the Caucasus. That this war is as good as won is what the German generals and Hitler thinks by mid-July 1941, only a few weeks into the invasion of the Soviet Union. It looks like that the projections that the German leaders had was correct, that this would be a victory that would come quickly. Well, it turns out not to be the case. Act Two, why we fight. Well, it's in this crisis time period that Churchill and Roosevelt get together in August 1941. The Soviet Union has now been attacked. This is a great new fact. The international environment has changed. The Soviet Union is no longer collaborating with Hitler's Germany. It is now opposed to Hitler's Germany. And so Churchill and Roosevelt, their top military advisors, political advisors, get together off the coast of Newfoundland to discuss what should be the war aims and what should be the strategy to bring about the defeat of Nazi Germany. And And there you see General Marshall on the left, Roosevelt talking with him. You see Admiral King, Admiral Stark, and Winston Churchill. And there was a service, church service, held on the fantail of the battleship Prince of Wales. And there's the president and the prime minister and their advisors around them and the crews of American and British warships. Again, remember, this is August 1941. And what gets hammered out from this meeting is the Atlantic Charter. People think, oh, the Atlantic Charter, it must be a long document. That's the whole Atlantic Charter. It has 8 points to it. There it is. As you can see, August 14, 1941, signed by the president, signed by the prime minister. It's a public document, okay? One of the main points is point number six. It says, after the final destruction of the Nazi tyranny, the United States isn't at war yet. This is before Pearl Harbor. And we're already committed publicly by the president to regime change, as we would say today, to overthrow the Nazi regime, to roll back the Nazi conquests and overthrow the Nazi regime. Again, very prominent in this document. Well, coming back, Roosevelt has to now face the American public. You can see the headline there. Again, pledging the destruction of Nazi tyranny. Big, bold letters in the New York Times front page. Well, what do the American public people think about this commitment? And here's some Gallup polling data from that time. There's one of the questions. How would you vote today on the question of the United States entering the war now against Germany? This is after the meeting with Churchill and the publication of the Atlantic Charter. Enter war, 21%. Stay out, 74%. No opinion, 5%. That's pretty overwhelming. When three quarters of the American public are saying, I don't like the idea of sending that army over to Europe to have to defeat Nazi Germany, to accomplish that aim of destroying the Nazi tyranny. Here's another question put to the American public. Of these two things, do you think is more important? Keep this country out of war, or that Germany be defeated? Okay, keep the country out of war or defeat Germany, even if there's a risk that the United States will go to war. Okay, that's the question. Defeat Germany, 57%. Stay out, 38%. No opinion, 5%. Now, what does this polling data tell us? Well, first of all, it tells us that 5% of the American public is clueless. Yeah, it is. It actually says a lot about our people that it's only 5%. But when you look at it, what you see is these are two very contradictory points of view that the American people have signed up on. God bless the American people that they can keep these two contradictory thoughts in their head at the same time. They don't want to fight the war against Germany, but they want to see Germany defeated. Again, they understand the danger from Nazi Germany. But at the same time, who's going to have to pay the cost, the sacrifice entailed to defeat Germany? This is actually very rational in a way when you think about it. Yeah, it's what I want to see happen, but I'm also aware that there's a cost involved. I have an aim, but I also have a cost. And that cost is staggering. It's bound to be staggering. Indeed, you have over 11.5 million people are in uniform by 1944 and 45 to accomplish that aim. Remember, 11.5 million on a population of 130 million. Extrapolate that to today, you'd be talking about 25 million people in uniform today on a country of over, 300 million. That's the level of effort that the United States has to generate to be able to defeat Imperial Japan and Nazi Germany. Okay, well, you can see for President Roosevelt, the American people, while they agree that they want to see the destruction of Nazi tyranny, they are skittish about having to pay that cost. And so this is the domestic political reality that President Roosevelt faces. Act Three, a new age begins. What age is that? It's the age we live in, the nuclear age. This is another great continuity over the last 75 years, the development of nuclear weapons. In Britain, British scientists and engineers looked into the possibility of developing nuclear weapons, and an important high-level report called the Maud Report was given to the British leadership. And here are some of the passages out of the report. It's recognized that developing nuclear weapons is going to be very expensive, but when you consider the destructive effect, both material and moral, every effort should go into producing these weapons. How long will it take? Well, the British scientists and engineers estimate that by the end of 43, an atomic bomb could be built. Now, we know the history. It's the summer of 45. It takes 18 months longer than what the British initially thought it would take. It was more difficult to do. And by the way, they don't know how the war is going to end. So they say, hey, and if the war ends before the end of 43, again, we know it ends in 45, these weapons, no country wants to be without them. So even if they're not useful in the war that they're fighting now, you want to have those weapons because this is a national security threat because of its decisive possibilities. Well, the Maud Report, its conclusions and recommendations are these. Again, a uranium bomb could lead to decisive results. Remember, this is in the context of the Soviet Union being attacked by Nazi Germany. Initially, the Germans doing well at the expense of the Soviet Union. Soviet Union might be defeated. How are you going to defeat Nazi Germany if the Soviet Union is defeated? Well, the British also recommend that Britain should collaborate with the United States in developing these weapons. Well, the Maud Report is given to the United States. President Roosevelt is briefed on it in October of 1941. In other words, about 2 months after he's met with Churchill. And he writes to Churchill about the briefing that he's gotten. Dr. Bush there that's mentioned in it is Vannevar Bush, his top scientific advisor. And he says, hey, we've looked into this Maud study, and what we want to do is collaborate with you, Britain, in the development of these weapons. Well, Churchill's response is, my dear President, thanks so much for your letter. We concur. So already before Pearl Harbor, the United States and Britain are committed to the development of nuclear weapons. First, research and development. But they're pretty clear that this is feasible, that the research and development will lead to a weapon, and that this weapon could be the decisive weapon in determining the outcome of the Second World War. Again, remember, this is being done before Pearl Harbor and our entry in the war. An important decision about American armaments and strategy is being made. Churchill had already written about nuclear weapons and the destructiveness of war. In an article he wrote, "Shall We Commit Suicide?" that appeared in 1924. Think about that. You know, we tend to think, oh, nobody knew about these things. No, already people are talking about the potential of nuclear weapons. Charles Eliot was a former president of Harvard University. He wrote, hey, everyone should read this pamphlet. Churchill in this article talks not just about the potential of nuclear weapons, but a lot of different weapons that could be developed and how the next war, just how deadly it will be. But again, Churchill is aware of the possibilities long before these decisions are being made. Act 4, war in Asia. So far I've focused on Europe, the danger from Nazi Germany, but there's also this other danger from Japan and East Asia. And I want to highlight something right up front, that neither Churchill nor Roosevelt were anti-Japanese. That back in the 20s, in fact, when Japan was seen as that responsible stakeholder, a great power that worked well with Britain and the United States, this is what Churchill thought about Japan. When the Royal Navy said, oh, we have to build up Singapore, we have to build up our Navy in the Pacific, Churchill said, why should we do that? There won't be a war with Japan, not the slightest chance in our lifetime. By the way, this is the first time Churchill appeared on Time magazine's cover. Back in 1923. That's what he looked like in that time. But again, notice, he said, no, Japan's not a danger. And Japan wasn't a danger in the 1920s. By the way, Franklin D. Roosevelt, in an article in 1923, also said, hey, most of the things that are driving the US and Japan, the problems that were leading to confrontation and crisis and potential war between Japan and the United States. They're all being resolved. They're being removed. As he said, they're on the road to eventual elimination. Don't you love that photograph? Again, of course, Roosevelt is recovering from polio, fighting back against his disease. And look at him gripping that pipe. What a remarkable photograph there, and that grin that that Roosevelt has. Again, you know, here we can say, boy, the crystal ball that Roosevelt and Churchill had, not very good. Turns out that Churchill and Roosevelt are in charge when Pearl Harbor occurs, and that war with Japan that they said, oh, it won't happen, it's on the road to never going to occur, being eliminated, all the problems, won't happen in our lifetime. Well, it does happen in their lifetime. And why is that? Well, in the 1920s, Japan was that responsible stakeholder, collaborating with Britain and the United States. But in the 1930s, in the wake of the Great Depression, the economic downturn, a militarization takes place of Japanese foreign policy and strategy. The military, the army in particular, and the navy both assert themselves in Japanese society, culture, and in politics. The New York Times correspondent at the time, in the 30s, wrote a book about it, published in 1942, as you can see, after Pearl Harbor, by the name of Hugh Bias. Isn't that a great name for a journalist? Bias. Not that journalists are biased. That's become a big campaign issue, hasn't it, this year? Yeah, huge. Well, anyway, but he wrote this book called Government by Assassination, and the title really does stick, which is that those people in Japan, political leaders, who opposed the militarist course that Japan was taking of expansion, fighting a war against China, some of them were being assassinated, prime ministers, treasury secretaries. And so as a result, Japan is becoming a dangerous power on the world scene. The Japan of 1930s is not the Japan of the 1920s. Hirohito, the emperor on the white horse. Already in the 1930s, this is what Churchill is writing about Japan in the mid-1930s, that the island empire of Japan is being gripped by a harsh military despotism. Japan is no longer a country that he can say, oh no, we won't have a war in our lifetime. He can see by the 1930s that there could well be a war with Japan. Now, this is the Emperor Hirohito I remember. Remember this in 1971 when he came to the United States and he went to Disneyland? Got a Disney watch there. I mean, look at the contrast. I mean, there's Hirohito on the horse, the emperor, like Napoleon, on his white horse. And here he is getting a Mickey Mouse watch. Okay. That was an important event, too, remember? When he came to the United States, very controversial in its time. Well, in 1937, as I said, Japan invades China, becomes involved in a protracted war with the Chinese. This is a war that Japan is not able to win. Now, they make great gains. They win almost every battle against the Chinese armed forces, the nationalist forces of Chiang Kai-shek. But China is a big country, as you know. It's a continent. And so they can't conquer the whole place. And Chiang Kai-shek and his forces keep fighting and won't give up. Well, what does the American public think about this? Well, here's another question put to the American public by the Gallup poll. Should the United States take steps to rein in Japan, even if it means risking war with Japan? Look at that figure. As you can see, an overwhelming majority of Americans think that the United States should take a tougher line toward Japan. Now, why is that? Well, one, as I've said, China and Japan have been at war for 4 years. 4 years before Pearl Harbor, these are the newsreels that we're seeing. Japanese troops bayoneting Chinese prisoners of war. This baby in a newsreel abandoned in the Shanghai, bombed out Shanghai railway station. This is like the five-year-old boy, you know, whose image we saw recently from Syria. Again, the American public is seeing how horrific the Japanese treatment is of the Chinese. Japanese military leaders are very consciously trying to terrorize the Chinese people, to beat them down. And this in the United States is looked at as being obnoxious, dangerous, that the Japanese are behaving this way. They are no longer the responsible stakeholder, By the way, as you know, the long-term consequences of this, you know, 75 years, 80 years later, are tremendous in Japanese-Chinese relations today. You know, the current Chinese regime in Beijing, you know, often bring out this anti-Japanese sentiment when playing up Chinese nationalism. So the memory of this has not gone away at all, despite the passage of time. Well, Roosevelt, to try to deter Japan from further aggressive acts, and also to gain leverage in negotiations with Japan, to try to wind down the war with China, get a negotiated end to it, deploys the American Pacific Fleet out to Hawaii as a deterrent, to be forward deployed closer to Japan. Now, this is the Naval War College up in Newport, Rhode Island, where I teach. Throughout the period between the two world wars, naval officers, marine officers, gamed out, looked at a potential war with Japan. It's called War Plan Orange. Orange was the code word given for Japan. Red was the code word given to Britain. We also gamed out wars against Great Britain, believe it or not. We had invasion plans to invade Canada. We were going to have four armies invade Canada. We also had black. Black was Germany. Well, here's Newport, Rhode Island, and they would game out different scenarios for how to wage war against Japan. This is the gaming floor in Pringle Hall, which is now the center for international officers. We have over 100 officers from around the world who attend the Naval War College, by the way. Well, here's what the typical scenario looked like. Japan begins the war on the offensive, seizing the Philippines, the Marianas. The United States builds up its naval forces. Japan consolidates its conquests. Once the United States feels strong enough, it strikes across the Pacific, breaks through, takes back the Marianas, Guam. Probably be a big battle there in the Marianas. Indeed, this is what happens. In June 1944, you have the Battle of the Philippine Sea. Admiral Raymond Spruance wins against the Japanese Navy, breaks the Japanese defense barrier. So this is a good projection of the reality of the history that's going to unfold. So this is what War Plan Orange basically looks like. Again, there were different variations. Well, as we like to say today, the enemy gets a vote. The Japanese start the war, as you know, not only with an invasion of the Philippines and taking Guam and moving against Singapore and Malaya, they also begin with a strike on Pearl Harbor. This is the brainchild of Admiral Yamamoto, commander of the combined Japanese fleet, the one that has been the Billy Moffat of the Japanese Navy, big advocate of naval aviation, of land-based naval aircraft and also aircraft carriers. And so now he's going to use those aircraft carriers to strike at the Pacific Fleet and its main base in Hawaii. Now, in 1941, at the end of November, you had the Army-Navy game played here in Philadelphia at what used to be called Sesquicentennial Stadium, which was John F. Kennedy Stadium, renamed. Remember that? Okay, at Sesquicentennial Stadium. Here's the cover of that program. And you can see the midshipmen standing tall and also the Corps cadets. Great cover. Look at the price, though, 50 cents. That's expensive for those days. Well, inside of the program for the Army-Navy game, you see this. It's a photograph of the battleship Arizona. Now, bear with me as I read the caption. That's the caption that is underneath it. A bow view of the U.S. Arizona, she plows into a huge swell. It is significant that despite the claims of air enthusiasts, no battleship has yet been sunk by bombs. November 29th, 1941, just a couple weeks before Pearl Harbor. And of course, of all the battleships in the U.S. Navy, what battleship is being held up as the emblem, as the unsinkable ship that aircraft can't? It's the Arizona. Well, you know what the Greeks would say of this, the ancient Greeks. This is hubris, tempting the fates, the gods. It's an arrogance. Well, we know the history and what happens to the Arizona. And these photographs of the Japanese carrier force closing in on the Hawaiian Islands and beginning their assault on Battleship Row, and a bomb is able to sink the Arizona, penetrating its armor, detonating in the magazine. Over 1,000 fatalities there on the Arizona. And that's what the Arizona, of course, looks like today, the memorial. Again, 75 years ago, the attack on Pearl Harbor, the headline of the New York Times the next day. President Roosevelt on December 8th going before a joint session of Congress to ask for a declaration of war. Now, Roosevelt had speechwriters, and so they gave him a draft for his speech. But you can see how Roosevelt then marks it up and starts to own this speech for himself. Now, notice the beginning. It says, "Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in world history." That's what his speechwriters gave him. But he changed it, as you can see. He took out the commas, put in a dash for more effect, and then put in that word infamy. And again, we remember that word, infamy, day of infamy. Well, that's Roosevelt's input into that speech. The speech by itself is very short. It's only 3 pages long. And it very much, even though the first draft is being done by the speechwriters, Roosevelt is very much doctoring it up and making it his own. Act five, global war. Well, what's the German response to all of this, the attack on Pearl Harbor? Well, on December 11th, 1941, Hitler goes to the Reichstag and asks for a declaration of war against the United States. And in his speech, and it goes for over an hour, again, you can YouTube it and listen to it, and indeed, Hitler's speeches are not read as much as they ought to be. They are incredibly revealing. When people say, oh, I didn't know about this or that, yeah, all you have to do is listen to his public proclamations. Well, he applauds the Japanese action. Again, this attack on Pearl Harbor against the United States, as he says, fills all of us, the German people, and as he says, all decent people. The decent people of the world are going to applaud what the Japanese have done. They've all tried to negotiate with this false man. There's a lot of reference in this speech to Roosevelt. Hitler goes out of his way to be derogatory about Roosevelt. They've finally had enough. The Japanese have finally had enough of this dishonorable president. By the way, Hitler also has his lawyers draw up for him a whole bill of indictment of how the United States has violated international law. He goes on and on and on about how the United States has violated international law, which again just shows, you know, how the devil is so good at knowing scripture. It is amazing, this speech. But he castigates the United States and says, we're going to war in part because we're the upholder of international law against the Americans who violate international law. And again, Hitler says, we know who stands behind Roosevelt. Why is Roosevelt taking these actions? Again, it's this vast Jewish conspiracy that's behind it all. He's strengthened in his resolve by the Jews surrounding him, Hitler says. And this diabolical meanness is all around Roosevelt, and he stretches out its hands to it. Hitler's the peacemaker. It's the American president that is the warmonger. Roosevelt has consistently tried to bring about war, whereas Hitler wants to solve peacefully problems. What planet is he living on? It's Roosevelt is the one that's trying to foment war around the world. Well, we know where it all goes. At this time, too, Hitler starts to give the orders to carry out the final solution, leading to Auschwitz. The Wannsee Conference of January 42, the global implications of what's taking place. This war has now become a big war of extermination of peoples. Well, at the end of December, December 26, 1941, Churchill gives a speech before a joint session of Congress. Germany is at war with the United States as well as with Britain. And this is Churchill's speech that he's written up. And as you can see in his own hand, he puts in about his American mother. His mother, Jenny Jerome, was born in Brooklyn. So Churchill is half American. And he says, I wish my mom could be here to see this moment, me speaking before a joint session of Congress. And then he tells a funny joke. He says, yeah, if my dad had been American and my mom British rather than the other way around, I would have been here earlier. Anyway, the end of his speech, final sentence, as he says, the United States, united as never before, has drawn the sword for freedom and cast away the scabbard. Again, we live with the consequences, the choices that were made 75 years ago. And there was nothing inevitable about any of this. Again, I want to highlight for you the choices that are being made. The choices that Churchill makes to continue fighting. Why? Because he trusts in America to come through. The choices that Roosevelt is making, not to be hemispheric in defense, but to support Churchill and Britain in the fight against Nazi Germany. The choices being made by Japan and Germany's leaders as well. There was nothing inevitable about any of these things. But we're living with the consequences of those events of 75 years ago. And I think one of the big takeaways of these events is again how the United States has to now play that larger role in the world. Without the United States being willing to support Britain at that time, Britain could well have folded. And that's a big lesson for us today. When we look around the world, our partners in other countries, when they look to the United States, if they see a weak United States, not weak because we don't have economic or military power, but weak because our leadership seems not willing to make the choice to support them, well, you can imagine what choices they're going to have to make and what they're going to have to do. So this period of 75 years ago, this history, is something that is very relevant for us today when we think about America's role in the world and how much more dangerous the world could be if the United States doesn't play that leadership role. Thank you very much.
Very good.
You want to do questions?
Sure. Take a few minutes.
Yeah, whatever.
Well, thank you, John. We have a couple of minutes for questions. That was, by the way, truly Shakespearean in presentation. Tom Trope.
Very simple question. Very simple question. You mentioned Hitler making the determination to invade Russia. Were the generals also in agreement with that decision he made, or did they just acquiesce as they had in his other decisions that he made with respect to invasions?
The generals did acquiesce. They thought that the generals in particular did not like the idea of trying to keep the war going against Britain. In Hitler's mind, the United States is coming into the war, eventually going to come into the war. They don't know when. Under some British and German estimates, the U.S. will get into the war in 1943. When our rearmament program has ramped up more. So they see that they have a window of opportunity to defeat the Soviet Union before the US comes into the war. So that's what they're thinking. And the generals agree with this. They're all in favor with Hitler in this regard. Hitler, by the way, also says, hey, this is not going to be a war like in Western Europe. This is going to be a war of extermination where we're going to shoot large numbers of people. And the army is going to be involved in this. And the generals, they don't protest it. Some of them do privately, oh, we're soldiers, not executioners. But it's amazing how much they too have been corrupted by Nazi ideology, the top German leadership, just like the German Foreign Service at this time. These are professionals, diplomats and soldiers, but at the same time, they've now adopted the Nazi worldview. So they're all on board for this. It's only the Navy that's hesitant and wants to continue to, and you can see it, for narrow bureaucratic interests, the Navy will have more of a role in a British first strategy rather than going against the Soviet Union.
I have a follow-up.
Yes.
Dr. Maurer, why do you think Stalin was so reluctant to believe that he will be attacked by Hitler? Is it because of the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact? Another reason.
Yeah, in August of 1939, the Soviet Union, in effect, becomes part of the Axis alliance. They are supplying Nazi Germany with food, resources, and the rest. And so Stalin is thinking, I'm giving Hitler everything he wants. Why would he attack me? Why would he open another front when he hasn't yet been able to defeat Britain? This is all a British attempt to embroil us in the war. And so Stalin's view is the British imperialists are trying to foment a war between Germany and Russia and see those two powers tied down in Eastern Europe and hence protect Britain. So Stalin is suspicious of the British. He's suspicious in particular of Churchill. He also doesn't see the sense of this because Stalin is one of the great appeasers. When we think of appeasement, we think of Neville Chamberlain. But in this case, Stalin is giving Hitler what he wants. So why would Hitler turn on him? So he wants to avoid war too. So it's also a wish on his part that he doesn't see the Soviet Union as ready yet for war to take on Nazi Germany. So it's a variety of factors that are going on there of why he doesn't think Hitler's going to attack him. But it proves to be wrong.
Sam Savitz, the microphone.
Just amazing to me, did not Hitler consider Napoleon's disaster? Why did he think he would succeed where Napoleon failed?
It is incredible with the advantage of hindsight. When we look at German planning, German military planning is abysmal. All too often, I think people think the Germans are super planners and all the rest. There's sort of a myth out there that the German military leadership are such consummate professionals that they get things right. Well, you know, like the earlier question, not only do they agree with Hitler attack the Soviet Union, but they think that this is going to be relatively easy. And in fact, the logistical preparations, even if they win, even if they take Moscow, even if they take Leningrad, there's going to be large numbers of German troops forward deployed in cold weather over winter. They don't provide nearly enough supplies, clothing, also lubricants and all the rest for warfare in wintertime. It's amazing. The other thing is the intelligence side. The Germans think that the Soviet Union has about 200 or so divisions. Well, they attack the Soviet Union, and lo and behold, they find out that there's actually 400 Soviet divisions. Something that is sort of rudimentary accounting of the number of enemy troops. They have gotten wrong. It also shows how good Soviet deception was, that the Germans didn't know what the overall strength of the Red Army was. But the Soviets were much stronger than what the Germans estimated. So if they only faced 200 divisions, what they were planning to fight, yeah, they would have won. But even if they had won the conventional battle, there was likely, given their policies of enslavement and extermination, they're going to face a big insurgency in the Soviet Union. So this war is bound to be protracted. By the way, Hitler was actually more realistic than his generals in this regard. He knew that there would be an insurgency out there, and he actually thought that that would be a good thing. Because, as he said, I don't want the German soldier to become weak. You know, if they have to constantly fight, you know, that's good. That'll make them better Germans. So, I mean, he understands in some way just what the stakes are there and how dangerous it's going to be and protracted the war is going to be, more so than his generals do. So it is amazing. By the way, once they failed outside of Moscow, all of a sudden everybody's reading, what happened to Napoleon? What happened to Napoleon? There. So they're studying it, but maybe a little too late. By the way, most of that speech of December 11th, or a great deal of that speech of December 11th of Hitler, where he declares war on the United States, is also an explanation of what's happened in the Soviet Union, that they haven't taken Moscow. And so Hitler is now explaining to the German people why they haven't been able to take Moscow. And the theme or thesis is, isn't it good that we attack the Soviet Union and that the German armies are at the gates of Moscow? Shows you how strong they are. If we hadn't attacked them, they would be at the gates of Berlin. So he turns it around and says, yeah, okay, we haven't done as well as we'd like, but at the same time, it was a good thing we did anyway.
Okay, we have time for one short last question, Nelson Wolf.
I'll try to make it short. The alliance between the United States, England, and even with Russia was fairly tight. I never understood Japan and Germany from simple things like how they use their submarines, and the Japanese didn't use convoys, to the fact that the Japanese did not enter against the Soviet Union when Germany invaded. Mm-hmm. Can you explain why this discordance in their relationship?
Yes, and one of the things that Roosevelt and Churchill are doing that is positively brilliant is that at their meeting where they wrote up the Atlantic Charter in August of 41, one of the things they want to prevent is the Japanese attacking the Soviet Union, because they fear that if Japan attacks the Soviet Union while the Germans are doing well in the West, that the Soviet Union's resistance will collapse. And so the harder line that the United States and Britain takes against Japan after August 41 is due in large part to prevent them from attacking the Soviet Union. It's a conscious choice on our part to tell the Japanese, we're putting pressure on you so that you don't have the wherewithal to attack the Soviet Union. So we contribute, if you will, to the Japanese not doing something that in retrospect would seem like a good strategy. By the way, the Japanese Army wanted to do that too. But because of the American economic pressure, it was thought, well, we can't attack the Soviet Union until we get resources of Southeast Asia, which means a war against Britain and the United States. So it focuses their attention toward the South rather than toward the North. The other thing about the Japanese at this time, the German-Japanese alliance is the Japanese don't, Germany declares war on the United States, but Japan, as you say, doesn't declare war on the Soviet Union. Hitler wants to support the Japanese because he believes now with Japan in the war, the Japanese will tie down large amounts of American forces in the Pacific, as they do. And so it gives him another year to be able to finish off the Soviet Union, 1942, before he has to worry about the Anglo-Americans coming in Western Europe. So that's one reason why he supports the Japanese. Now, the Japanese, with a war in China, a war now with Britain and the United States, don't want to fight the Soviet Union. They have too much on their hands. The Japanese army is overextended, and they can't fight that. In April of 41, Japan and the Soviet Union signed a non-aggression pact, much like the Hitler-Stalin pact of August of 39. And so most of our lend-lease, about 45% of American lend-lease in the Second World War, goes across the Pacific. You know, on Liberty ships, it goes from, you know, Vancouver, from our western ports, sails across under a Soviet flag, across the Pacific to Vladivostok, where it then gets put on, you know, the railway line and gets shipped to wherever in the Soviet Union. We're feeding, by 43, we're providing food for 11 million Soviet citizens. That's the size of the Red Army. We're basically feeding the Red Army. We're also supplying the Soviet Union not with tanks or artillery tubes or aircraft, because they're quite good at building those themselves, but with jeeps and trucks. So the Red Army, when it goes into Berlin and Vienna in 45, they're driving into Berlin on Studebaker trucks and American jeeps. And that isn't molested by the Japanese, because they're both neutral toward each other. So this important critical supply line through the whole Second World War is open, supporting the Soviet Union against Nazi Germany. And it's really important by 43 on in enabling the Red Army to get competitive with the German Army. So it's not a small thing. It's very important, as your question highlights.
Could you please comment on the use of their submarines? The Japanese used their submarines against catapults,
right?
Not against merchant shipping. We used ours against merchant shipping. The German used theirs against merchant shipping.
Yeah.
Why wasn't this communication given between the two countries?
The Japanese Navy was so concerned about the naval balance of forces, they wanted their submarines to sink American warships and be used for that purpose rather than against merchant shipping. The other factor is that the Japanese didn't have good intelligence about shipping, Allied shipping. Almost all of our shipping is convoyed, and the Pacific is a big ocean, and it's just hard to find. So the Japanese, in addition, just gave up on it. They said, this is too hard of a problem. It was easier for us because we know what the sea lanes are, stretching from Brunei and Southeast Asia back to Japan. if you put American submarines along that shipping lane, eventually they'll find ships to sink. And by 44 and 45, we're sinking a lot of the Japanese merchant fleet. The Japanese make a big mistake by not convoying their ships. They should have done that. That was one of the great lessons of the First World War. So the Japanese focus their submarines on warships. They also have come to the conclusion that sinking American, British merchant shipping won't be effective. And then they don't convoy their own ships. So it's a big mistake.
Thank you very much. Join me in thanking John Maurer. I think it should be said that John epitomizes the FPRI way. He looks at the chessboard and he explains how all the players on the board look at each other and see how to go forward. So we thank you, John, for excellent remarks. Before you go, I should mention, I'll get to the hats, Eli. I should mention that you have our calendars on your seats, but we do have one program not on the calendar. On this Thursday at lunchtime at the Union League is a talk by Mike Doran on his new book, Ike's Gamble, America's Rise to Dominance in the Middle East. It might better have been titled, What Eisenhower Could Teach the Next President About the Middle East. So it's worth joining us for. For details, just call our office. He's also speaking that night, Thursday night in Princeton on the same subject. Friday, November 4th, we're hosting Rosa Brooks talking about her new book on our main line series, How War Became Everything and How Everything Became the Military. It is quite a fascinating book about how our military has changed in the age of drones and cyber and other new technologies, and it's she'll be absolutely fascinating, I can assure you. And then on Election Day, November 8th, we're hosting Geopolitics with Granieri, David Eisenhower, to talk, try to make sense of this unusual election. Thank you for joining us, and don't forget to buy a cap at the back.